ทีนะคะโอเคค่ะเริ่มเลยนะคะ welcome everyone to the 3 minute โอเคขอเริ่มใหม่นะคะ
ได้ด้วยเหรอ
หนูตื่นเต้น
อ
ะ
อย่างนี้ได้ด้วยเหรอพี่ปานไม่น่าได้นะ
โอเค so good afternoon everyone welcome to 3 minute thesis competition I am ปานนะคะ
and my name is Pat
we are from theEngineering Graduate Student Association or EGSA EGSA and this is a great honor to be here our great honor to be here as an MC okay this is the semi-final round of 3-minute thesis hosted by the Faculty of Engineering จุฬาลงกรณ์ University and we collaborate withTotal Access Communication Company or we know as DTAC นะคะSo first of all, we would like to give you an official welcoming speech from the Associate Dean of the Faculty of Engineering. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Associate Professor Pi Sut Pien Manakun ka.
Okay, thank you very much. It's also really my pleasure to be here. And it's really good thing that we can finally organize this 3-minute thesis. That it can be possibly the very first 3-minute thesis in Thailand. Yes. And also thank you for sure that for DTAC.That try to support us and give this event to be real. And also, I would like to thank our judges from many faculties and also our commentators, right, from several fields and several technical fields. Okay. First of all, for the last 6 months.That we think about how to organize this one. It's very difficult. It's very difficult. However, when we just focus and thinking about the 21st century skills, that I believe that all of you know about this one. And the one from 4C in 21st century skills is communications, right?Okay, so as we know that the communication should be one of the major parts for our futures and it's going to be the essential skill for everyone, not only you, me also. Okay, and then we know that English should be main part for that one. Even though you graduate your master or PhD, but you cannot communicate your work or your knowledgeIn English, that we can share that this one is going to be the very universal language in the world. Okay, so this is the main reason that why we collaborate the brand with University of Queensland in Australia. We bring this brand, the 3-minute thesis, to Thailand and to Chulalongkorn Universities. Okay, so this is my really pleasure that finally.We can have more than 80 participants for the first round. It means that we have more than 80 video clip from all students from Jula. And then our staff take very long time, imagine, to see every 3 minutes for more than 80 video clip. And give a big hand to you and yourself that you are the last 20 participants, okay? Give a big hand to all of you, please. So, it's already 3 minutes, I think. After this moment, okay, I hope that for you all 20 participants and everyone can enjoy this event. And thenIt can be something in this event can motivate you in the future about communicate, about how to connect in English or something else. Okay, but I hope that this one can be something inspiration for you in the future. And do as good as you can. Okay? You have 3 minutes. And thank you. And I hope that this event will be really success. And for sure, we're going to organize this 3 minute thesis again and again in Jurongkorn universities. And we hope that for the next time, we're going to have another participant from different universities here in Jura. Thank you very much. ขอบคุณครับ
Thank you very much นะคะอาจารย์พิเศษ So next I would like to give you a short story of 3 minute thesis. 3 minute thesis was first held in the University of Queensland in Australia in 2008, and a couple of years later, the concept of 3 minutes has been promoted and adopted in many universities throughout New Zealand and Australia, and the competition was first held in 2010 at the University of Queensland. And since 2011, 3 minute thesis competition has been more popular and were adopted by many universities worldwide. And today is the turn of Chulalongkorn University. We believe that the competition is a great addition to graduate students and is an excellent opportunity to publicize the work. I'm sorry. We hope that 3 minute thesis competition contribute benefits to all of competitors, not only in academic knowledge, but also useful expertise in terms of public speaking, effective communication in limited time, and attractive presentation slide technique. We also believe that these skills will be applicable for further research and work. And the campaign could be one of valuable experience for all competitors. And in this competition, all competitors must follow the rules. I believe that everyone knows the rules. All speakers has to finish their speech, their talk in 3 minutes with one slide. And the slide should be static. No animation, no movement, no song, no rap, and use like an only spoken word, no poem, no song. And also then I will mention the judging criteria for today. Okay, skip it, please. Okay, for this judging criteria for today, I will go through it quickly. We will mark the speaker by the comprehension and content. You can look at it like briefly. I don't read all of them. Actually, I can summarize like you have a clear background of the research and clear research question. You have a logical sequence of the presentation. Use the appropriate language that non-specialists can understand your presentation. And no terminology. No terminology, and have a good time management during the 3 minutes. And next is the engagement and communication. We look at you can enhance the audience want to know about your research more and more. Not generalize your research. You have audience attention. You have a good state performance. And you have a good and clear slide. Your PowerPoint.
And before we continue, in this occasion, it's our great honor to invite คุณนาลดีอาจหารวงหรือ or คุณกุ้ง the chief people officer to give us a welcoming speech. Everyone please give a big round of applause.
สวัสดีค่ะ Hi, I'm supposed to speak English, right, Vinto? So hi, everybody. On behalf of DTAC, welcome you guys to our office and also to this event, the 3 minutes thesis. So very, very glad to have the initial activities with the Chulalongkorn University to support this activity, right? So this is, would be the first step that we can do something for Chula and then for DTAC going and for the students going forward. But first of all, personally, I'm so excited also to join, to witness this event also. It's quite interesting to see, you know, for the contestants or the speaker who have worked on the thesis, I'm sure you have been working on this piece of work for a long, long time, but you have to present it in 3 minutes, you know. Probably we would learn from this, like how to, I think in our DTAC language, we said how to frame the issues, you know. Communication is so important. And then if somebody can talk about some sophisticated thing, but in the simple way, that communication would be the best. So good luck for the contestants, everybody, and then enjoy this afternoon. Thank you.
Okay, we'll be continue with the next slide. As you guys know that today is the preliminary round. On today, the 10 competitors will be determined to pass to the final round that will be held on the NITAS 17 event on 19 March at the main auditorium of the Faculty of Engineering. And on that day, the audience could be faculty members, students, or the general public. And on that day, everyone have the right to vote for the top People Choice Award. And in the final round, the winner, the two runner-up, and the top People Choice vote competitors will receive the thesis grant. The winner will receive the thesis grant for 30,000 baht. The first runner-up and the second runner-up will receive 30,000 and 20,000 baht respectively. And the top People Choice vote competitors will receive 10,000 baht. And in this occasion today, we delighted to announce that if the winner of this competition is the PhD student, they will get the chance to challenge themselves in the next big round, in the 3 minute thesis Asia Pacific round. And they will get the supporting from Chulalongkorn University. And importantly, this opportunity is not happen to only just one person, but two. So I hope you guys do your best for get these opportunities.
Okay, then I will mention you about our judges today. We have 5 judges from like in many fields. So go for the first one. He sit in the middle. I believe that you know him already. He is an associate dean of the Faculty of Engineering, Ajahn Pisut Pien Manakun ka. And the next is, she is from the Department of English, the Faculty of Art. Please welcome Associate Professor Natthama Pongpairoth ka. And the next, he sit on my right hand. He is a professional at presentation, creativity, and he is also one of TEDx Chulalongkorn team. He is from the Department of Computer Engineering. Please welcome Ajahn Dr. Thongchai Roth Gangsadan. And we also, last two judges, we have the PhD student of Chulalongkorn University. Please welcome Khun Virin Kitithammawong and Khun Phudit Chatusithangkun ka.
And for today, it is our great honor to introduce all of the commentators. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Assistant Professor Manoj Loha Tepanon, the Associate Dean of Faculty of Engineering. And the next commentator is Ajahn Dr. Akhawat Sirisuk from the Department of Chemical Engineering. And our last honored commentator, he is the co-founder of Scooter, Khun Suwat Pathom Pakawan or Khun Boy.
So now we will begin the speaking session. As you know, today we have 18 speakers and it divides into two groups. In the first group, we have is an order of speaking. The first speaker is, in the first group, we have Kun Atima Punyawa, and we have Kun Ailada Shupara. Next is Kun Intira Techamani, and Kun Gan Chai Suwan, and then Kun Kittiyapong Jantaradet, Kun Lalita Khonhan, Kun Nithipan Suksumek, Kun Panagon, Kun Panagon Chao Ang Thong, and Kun Pen Picha Sathanwat. And now we will start with the first speaker. Please welcome Kun Atima Puyawa. She's from the Department of Microbiology, the Faculty of Science, and her title is Bacterial Dyes Sensitize Solar Cells. Please welcome.
Can you imagine your life without electricity? No light, no phone, no facility. It will become more difficult. However, there are some areas on this world still not access to electricity. Some far are places like countryside, forest, or mountain, a lack of electric generator. Moreover, combustion of petroleum can cause greenhouse gas and lead to climate change. So, we are looking for an alternative energy source, which is renewable and less harmful. One potential source is solar energy. It is clean energy and can fly everywhere. The challenge is how to convert it into usable form by a simple technique. In my research, I work with DSSC, or dye sensitized solar cell. This is a type of solar cell which has working principle similar to photosynthesis system in plant. Dye molecule will capture sunlight, generate electron flow, and make electricity. DSSC are more attractive than silicon-based solar cell because it is cheaper, easier to produce, and can work under low light intensity. Unfortunately, synthesized organic dye using in DSSC can cause environmental problems due to their toxicity and hard degradation. In my research, I study pigment from photosynthetic bacteria, which consists of bacterial chlorophyll and carotenoid. This bacteria can be found in water resources where light is available. They produce pigment to absorb light and use as energy source for their growth. The pigment of this bacteria can absorb light both of visible light and near infrared lesion. So they can be used as dye sensitizer for current production by DSSC. In my current work, solar cells were made by coating bacterial pigment on semiconductor surface at the anode. Then the counter electrode is combined and filled with liquid electrolyte to make a complete cell. This bacterial dye synthesized solar cells show an impressive photo to current conversion efficiency as 0.19% with higher than some other natural dye. Next, how to make it more usable in real life? I plan to connect a series of bacterial dye solar cells with a battery and a light bulb. Thus, we can create a mini solar lighting system for use in rural areas. In daytime, small pigment of bacteria will capture sunlight and transform into bright light at nighttime. Thank you.
Okay, let's hear a briefly comment and helpful comment from the commentators.
Okay, I'll begin. Wow, thank you. You've had a perfect timing, it's only 3 seconds left. I was kind of like, wish I could go over it. So that was good. And I think I can feel the excitement, you know, coming through your voice. And but I think that's normal, I guess, for a practitioner like yourself. So overall, I think you did a good job. I would comment though that you still spill out some jargons, some scientific jargons that may be difficult for people outside of your area to understand. So maybe if you could kind of tone it down a little bit, that would help. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so nice presentation. I do the SSC also. So I think you need to pronounce your words more clearly, okay, so that people can understand you better, right? And then I think you spend a little more too much time on the introduction, like, and spend less time on the content of your thesis. So maybe you could cut down on the introduction and then beef up your content, make it more interesting.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm an engineer, but I have no idea what you just said. but from my side of view is I want to hear a little bit more of the applications after if you have accomplished this project, what would be the commercialization of this? How the world can use it to commercialize it? Do you know what I mean? It's like
commercial.
Yeah, it's like how in commercial world can use this effectively? Yeah.
I plan to connect with the battery.
Yeah, yeah.
This cell can generate electricity, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But it's quite low, so I plan to connect with battery to collect it.
Yeah, but I mean, if you sell this solution to some like the company called Tesla or something, is that a possibility? Why would you do this at the first place? You know what I mean? I'm not asking. I just want to hear a little bit more at the end.
I think in my work, yeah, still have some improvement because it's conversion efficiency is quite low.
Yeah.
We need to improve some parts of cells to match with my pigments. Bacterial pigments.
Yeah. Okay. So, it just the comment at the very last presentation, at the very last word, you should say something like, if you have complete this project, it can make billions of people around the world.
I think it's suitable for rural area.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, and 70% of the populations of the world is in rural area. So
yeah.
So just to emphasize this, that why it's actually important to the world. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Kun Airada Chuphala. She is from the Department of Biotechnology, the Faculty of Science. And she come with the title of development and evaluation of loop mediated isothermal amplification for portable bacterial and fungi detection. So please welcome Kun Airada Chuphala.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Airada Chuphala. I'm studying in Program Biotechnology, Faculty of Science. I'm really interested in drinking water. I know you are bored when somebody ever tell you that water is essential for life or you have to drink water at classes every day. But today, I don't want to tell about that. I want to show you in our world population. You know, just 91% had access to improve the drinking water source. And what happened to the rest? There are 4.2 million people get water to a pipe. 1.8 billion people use the drinking water source contaminated with the feces. And 663 million people rely on unimproved source. It's also ashamed because I must say that their life depends on the surface water. Imagine if you are in that group and you see three glasses of water, which one would you choose? Maybe you will answer the first or the second one because it appears clear. But are you sure? Sometimes the clear water not necessarily be clean, right? Maybe it have bacteria or fungi which cause the disease, right? Diarrhea, dysentery, circular, typhoid, and polio. Hence, my project will help you in choosing the right one for you. As I'm going to develop the portable bacteria and fungi detection as per ISO standards. This innovation uses a new technology of the DNA amplification. Also, it looks like difficult, but you don't worry because it's very easy to use. You just drop your water, put it on the heat pad, wait, and read the result. And finally, you will know which glass you can choose. Thank you.
Commentator, please.
Okay. I like that you move around and you have a good eye contact with the audience. And I like that you use your slide and connect it to your presentation. But I think that's not enough content. It's like too many frivolous stuff.
I like you paint the pain picture very well, but you spend a little bit too much time on that and less time on the solution. So. Yeah.
I guess I will repeat what the other two commentators have said, that you use the PowerPoint, but it's not very effective. You know, in the beginning, you get a very good overview of the problem, but you started out by throwing numbers at the audience, which for myself, I cannot follow. I cannot catch up. You know, 2 billion, 1.5 million, and so on. It would be much more helpful if you put that graph on your presentation instead of these three glasses, okay? And that is one part. And I also agree with the other commentator that you provide too little information about your work. You know, you said, okay, your tools would help identify the glasses of water that is suitable for drinking, but how does it work? And how reliable is it? You know, you left these questions unanswered. So in order to pitch it more forcefully, I think we should work a little bit on that. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So our third speaker is... Okay. Our third speaker is Khun Intira Techamani. She is from Industrial Engineering, actually, from the Faculty of Engineering, with the title Development. Oops, I think it's the same, right? I think okay. She's come with the title Simulation and Optimization for Multi-Reservoir System Operation in the Jiao Preya River Basin. So please welcome Khun Intira ka.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'm going to tell you about my research. Before we start, I would like to ask, what's the most important to your life? Some people think their family. Some may say their jobs, their business, health, or wealth. The answer varies from people to people. But if you think carefully, all those answers share a common fundamental element, which is water. Everyone and every family need water to drink and to use. Business cannot be run without water. It's clear and undeniable that water is crucial, not only to humans, but also to other living organisms and environment. The managing water demand and supply is more challenging than before because of climate change and the higher number of population. I need more water to consumption and production. Why? We only have limited amount of water. What should we do? Here's come my research. I aim to use an optimization technique to improve water allocation and to provide and to explore the alternative for preventing flood and drought. I start by creating a river network and related infrastructure. Then the alternative function and constraint were set. The example of alternative function are minimizing water deficit, minimizing flood damage, and maximizing economic value generated by water. The constraint could be the amount of water arrival, the maximum capacity of water infrastructure and channel used for allocation. The result from the model were optimal reservoir release that met with the assertive function set at the earlier step. The possible solution to reduce excess or shortage of water were to construct the bypass channel to allow water transfer between neighboring basins, or to provide a retention ponds that can be used at the flood storage during the wet season and can be used as the additional water resource during the dry season. This is to show how optimization can be used to create opportunity for improved water efficiency. Thank you.
I like your presentation, but I want higher or lower voice because it's like and it sounds boring, but actually if you listen to it, it has a lot of content, but it just I need more, you know.
Thank you.
Well, this happens to be my area of expertise. So when you mentioned optimization, that's kind of piqued my interest. But to be frank, I could not determine how you do these allocations. Okay, so that was missing for the presentation, but maybe it only for me because I'm familiar with this. And the other thing is, you mentioned about water allocation. So that is something that might be of interest to the audience, you know, how you do water allocation and how easy or difficult it is. And the other aspect I can think of that you maybe didn't mention is about when you do this kind of data analysis, it's deterministic versus, you know, probabilistic nature of the problem that is not there. Okay, thank you.
Yes, I agree. It's like your presentation is a bit monotonous, right? So it's very stable and could be put to sleep. So you need to kind of like stress your point a little bit to make sure this is an important point so that you capture the attention of the audience. And then it sounds like you're reciting a script. Like you're reciting, it's like blah, 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 blah. Like you're like saying a mantra or something. But I like the content, but then that's a moment that like when you talk about it and you turn back and read off your slide, that is a no-no for me. Because the audience see your slide and you already know what's on the slide, you don't need to look back, right? You just talk about it. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so next speaker is Khun Kan Chai Suwan. He's from the Mechanical Engineering, the Faculty of Engineering, and his title is Energy Consumption of Plug-in Hybrid Electric Vehicle Based on Real-World Driving Driving Patterns, a case study in Bangkok.
Nowadays, you can see a lot of cars on the roads, especially in Bangkok. They break your health because they emit many pollutants. Not only that, they consume gasoline as their energy source. Their energy source, and you know that the gasoline is limited and costs highly. Can we do anything to make a change on this? Yes, we can. I think everyone here has ever heard about electric car. They consume electricity, so they can save more energy. Especially in the heavy traffic condition like Bangkok. And they emit less pollutant, so they are better for our health. And why don't we choose the electric car instead of normal car right now? Because we lack of the database about driving pattern in the area. So we don't know how much the energy they can save. And is it really worth? Because the electric car is quite expensive. And we don't know how much they can run, how far they can run. If we want to launch the electric car in the market in the Thailand, we have to deal with this problem. That is why we do this study. What we will do in this study is we collect driving data of the route in the Bangkok. We select the route by consider average driving speed and the number of cars on each route. And then we estimate the energy used when penetrate electric car by number. And we expect that the more electric car penetration, the more energy saving. And this can support to launch the policy about electric car in Bangkok and also in Thailand by the government. Meaning that it's possible that you can have a better health, a cheaper energy cost, and cheaper electric car. So you can have your own electric car really soon, but you don't have to pay highly for it. Thank you.
Kun Kan, right?
Yes.
It feels like you are exhausting your energy while you speak. Almost like, oh, I'm almost done, you know, almost dead at every sentence that you spoke. So you need to put more energy into your presentation. I guess that's what I'm saying. And for the topic itself, I think this topic is, in some sense, it's a straightforward topic that, you know, EV should consume less energy, therefore it should save fuel costs or whatever. But I think the essence of the thesis itself should be that, you know, how much energy does it really help saving?
We will penetrate in the percent of electric,
right,
electric car.
So
maybe 30%, 60%, and 90%.
Right.
Like that.
Do you have that numbers right now as your results?
No.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe that's why at this point may not be the good part for you to make this kind of presentation, because you don't have that kind of information for us.
Yes.
If only you come up to say that, you know, EV would save us so and so, then
I tell you that we expect your results.
Right. But we know, without you having to do this research, we know that you will save. So what we don't know is how much.
How much.
So that how much is important.
Okay, I agree with Nam. I know it feels like you like pause and play too many like silence, right? So you should try to eliminate that as much as possible, and probably a little bit more eye contact to the audience. I think you could keep looking at the floor. I don't know what's on the floor. Maybe you have script on the floor or something. And another thing, like, I have no idea what penetration in your sense means. My idea of penetration is not a good word, but your definition of penetration
could be a good word, but I have no idea what it meant. And it seems like it's the main focus of your talk, so maybe you should elaborate on the definition of penetration first.
I agree. I think you should memorize your lines a little bit more fluid. You talked in words and it's combined into phrases. It's just very difficult to concentrate on your presentation. And I like to see more of the deck. I think it's you could put a little bit more information on this, more than just numbers of cards here. Yeah.
Thank you.
So the next speaker is Khun Krittaya Phong Jantaradet. He's from the Environmental Engineering, and he's come with the title of Biocontrol of Sulfate Reduction Bacteria Using a Newly Isolated Lytic Bacteriophage.
Thank you. Okay. The wastewater from the starch industry, food industry, and paper industry have the high organic compounds. I recommend the industry to use the anaerobic bioreactor because this system can give the energy back to industry. In the normal case, the wastewater from this wastewater to treat with the anaerobic bioreactor. Used in the microbial in the anaerobic bioreactor. The microbial in anaerobic bioreactor have the sulfate reducing bacteria and general microbe. The general microbe can produce a biogas in the methane form and reduce and tease the organic compounds. But the sulfate reducing bacteria is the trouble in this system because it can reduce and treat the organic compound, but it can produce the hydrogen sulfide in this system. If the hydrogen sulfide form the molecule with the water, it can collision in infrastructure of the anaerobic bioreactor. And if the hydrogen sulfide contaminate in the biogas cannot to convert to another energy in industry. The industry must have the post-treatment with the scrubber or bio-scrubber to clean up the biogas before. In my thesis, focus on to apply the newly isolated lytic bacteriophage with the pre-treatment in the case number 2. I add the phage into the anaerobic bioreactor directly. The phage is the virus. The phage have an ability to control and die micro community. The phage can attack the sulfate reducing bacteria directly and specifically. After that, the sulfate reducing bacteria is die, it cannot to produce the hydrogen sulfide. The methane and biogas is pure and can convert to the energy directly, include the electric power and heat. The benefits of my thesis is industry can cut the post-treatment and save the cost to operate this system. Thank you.
I quite like your presentation. I think you have a lot of energies on the stage, and but I would like to see you looking at audience more than read up from the from your deck.
Okay, I like your presentations as well, right? I think you give us information to cover the whole like your thesis, so we know what you want to do and why you want to do it, right? But then you mentioned the word anaerobic, like very
many, many times, right? I know what anaerobic is, but I yes, it's like without using oxygen, right? But then Ajahn from the Faculty of Arts, she might not know what anaerobic bioreactor is, right? And then you mentioned a bacteriophage, and then you say the phage is a virus, but then a bacteriophage, what does it really mean? Is it bacteria or a virus? Get confused a little bit. Otherwise, it's pretty good to me.
Okay, I'll be different from other commentators here. You lost me, totally. I had no idea what you spoke about. Okay, it contains a lot of scientific terms that even I'm from engineering, I don't understand. Okay, maybe a different field of engineering. So in terms of the content, you totally lost me. But in terms of the engagement and speaking, I think that you did well. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. And our next speaker is Kun Lalita Konhan. She is from the physical chemistry from the Faculty of Science. And she come with popping mechanism of pop rice.
Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Lalita Konhan, a master's student from Department of Chemistry, Faculty of Science. Today, I will share you the amazing phenomena of one of our cultural heritage, the pop rice, and how I transform the pop rice and my research finding into the value-added innovative product. The product is the AeriFacial with the naturally biodegradable property. So, the process for making pop rice is very easy, just like the popcorn. We just heat the unmilled rice can look like this one on the pan for a minute. After that, the moisture inside the grain, will be superheat and making the start kanu explode at about 200 degrees Celsius. Although the rice grain contains 13% moisture content, but only 5% moisture involved in the popping process. When I calculate the pressure inside the grain, the value go up to 270 pounds per square inch, or PSI. The high pressure shoot up the pop rice more than 100 centimeters in the air. In the contrast, the pressure inside the popcorn is just 140 psi and it makes the popcorn jump only 6 centimeters. Okay, the popping of rice, blow up the thousands of 10 micrometers start granule into a 100 micrometer porous start balloon with 20 times volume expansion larger than the original grain. To give you an idea how high the pressure in at the popping moment, let's compare it with the tire pressure in the car. Do you know the tire pressure in your car is only 30 psi, which is x times smaller than the pressure at the popping moment? Finally, I transform the pop rice into the absorbent materials for the containing the essential oil and make into a product with the special design package. the oil will not leak out, but it can release, slow release and perfume in your environment, and my product can make your rooms, your car, or your kitchens are always fresh more than 3 months. And I'm sure that when you use my product, you will be happy. Thank you and have a nice day.
Well, thank you, Lalita. I think that was a great presentation, and I think you kept the audience attention very well. And you make a very good, interesting case with the popcorn and pop rice thing. But I miss the connection between the pop rice and your product. You know, how did you turn your pop rice into your product, and how does it become aromatic and You see, that's a missing part, I guess. That's
okay. My product is the.
It's okay. It's not a question and answer session.
Okay,
sorry.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Yes. Well, you manage your time very, very good, very well. Right. It's like one second left. I think it's your slide is very interesting. The comparison with the popcorn. Okay, can bring us to a certain level of like curiosity, right? But then later I found that it's not exactly the same thing, right? And then in the middle, you went very technical. Oh, this, like you heat this at 210 degrees Celsius, this will jump into this micron, this blah, 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 blah. For people outside of engineering field, you will lose them. You will lose their attention. Right, so I think like you may talk about how this pop rice will work into your product. What kind of properties would you take the benefit and use as your absorbent? And I think the rule said no props on stage, right? So you show your rice. So I don't think that's fair to other people. Yeah.
In contrast, I actually waiting for the whole presentation for the last 5 seconds. So I very interesting presentation. I was just waiting. So what am I going to use this for? So maybe you can bring that a little bit earlier than you keep people interested in your presentation.
Okay. Thank you.
So the next speaker is Khun Nithipan Suksumek. He's from Health Development, the Faculty of Medicine. And his title is Sugar Sucrose for Pain Relief in Eye Exam in Premature Baby.
How do you feel when you cry? Probably you are sad. But how do children feel when they cry? Probably they are hungry. But how the premature baby born cry, it's not just only emotion, but it can relate to the major handicap when they grow up. For me, not as a doctor, not as a parent, but as a human, if I know something to make the baby getting worse, I won't ignore that. The prematurely born infants are the infants who were born at less than 7 months of pregnancy. They have to do the eye examination to detect the visual blindness. Why? Because the major cause of blindness in preterm infant depends on an oxygen and the treatment in the hospital. And premature infants will have a severe pain when do the eye exam. The preterm infants have a sensitive and delicate brain and the vessel of the brain. If they cry too much, it will increase the blood pressure to the brain and cause the bleeding in the brain. And when they grow up, it will make the limb weakness or handicap. My master's degree research was focused on whether oral sucrose or sweet substance can decrease the pain during the eye exam. Why sucrose? Because sucrose will increase the releasing of the endorphin or happy substance in the brain. And we hope that it might decrease the pain during the eye exam. And sucrose is safe, easy to use, cheap, and we use it in our hospital in Thailand. We conducted a randomized control trial in preterm infants, divided infants into two groups. Group one received sucrose, and another group received sterile water, and detect the pain during the eye exam. The pain score were consisting of 5 categories: crying, facial expression, movements, tone, and change of the heart rate, and compare two groups. We surprisingly found the pain score in infants who receive the sucrose have a lower pain score comparing to the control. That is the surprisingly found, and it is the beginnings and first successful. We hope that this is the little things can make the different change. We hope that the infants, the preterm infants with less cries, less pain, will grow up with healthy happiness, good vision, and no handicap. Thank you.
I like your presentation a lot. Okay, you have introduction, you have your experimental setup, you give your result, so it covers the whole thesis, and you speak it very clearly. So I understand most of your presentation. The one thing I don't like is that slide is a bit too graphic for many people. I don't want to see babies getting eye exam. This is very disturbing for me sometimes. So. I love your presentation. I love how you present yourself. I love how you present the case. I love you started with the pain and then how you're going to solve the solution. I would make more. I would make the slides more attractive.
Yeah. Oh, thank you, Khun Nithipan. I think that was great. I have nothing further to add. That was perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.
And so the next speaker is Khun Pannakorn Chao Ang Thong. He's from Computer Engineering, the faculty of, she's from Computer Engineering. And her title is Northern Thai Dialect Text to Speech.
Hi everyone. A greeting in my language. Sawasdee Jiao. Some of you guys might feel wondering why I say Sawasdee Jiao, why I don't say Sawasdee Ka. Is that Thai? I think I learned Thai before. Most of foreigner and Thai people start learn Thai from the center Thai dialect, which is the standard one. But we have issue between people who came from different area. From the National Statistics Office in 2010 report that they have 5.6%. In the Northern, that people are uneducated. They cannot read, they cannot write, and they don't understand Center Thai dialect. In the among of those people, also including people who can speak only Northern Thai dialect. We're bringing us the idea to make Northern Thai dialect take to speed. The same idea as Google Translate. This you will get the input text file in the standard Thai dialect. The program will translate and synthesize the speech file in the Northern Thai dialect. From the Joula TTS structure, we change two engine insights. The first one, grapheme to phoneme with stand form G2P. We made the rubric and dictionary to invest the new engine that support Northern Thai dialect and makes the new speed model. All over our system was estimated by the professional of the language, native Thai speaker, and we get the all acceptable result in accent, nationalness, and intangibility. At the end, our program is not just only web application that you can use for communicate with Northern people who cannot speak Thai. Standard ones, but it's also the self-learning that you can use anywhere, anytime that you want. Thank you so much.
You have almost 1 minute left, so you are very energetic. I like your stage presence. But the slides need a big improvement. It's too many things in one slide, and actually it's a very, very simple topic. So you could make it very, very simple, not too much text and pictures.
Yeah, I agree that it's simple, and my thought was it's too much generalization. That Google Translate and so on and so forth. So the essence of your work, I mean, I couldn't find it. What is the essence of your work that makes this thesis worthwhile? Okay, so and I think you need to focus, to find the focus of the thesis. Right now it's only introduction.
Okay, I like the beginning of your talk. It captures the attention of the audience, but then you start to lose me a little bit towards the end.
and the slide is pretty busy. I think you can just reduce it to only a few items on that. So, like, for example, like, that graph doesn't do me any good, right? I have no idea what the scoring system means. Is it out of 10? Is it out of 5? Out of 4? Is it like a good thing? Is it a bad thing? And I don't think like Northern people will like to be represented by like that photo, okay? And and cannot. There's no space between can and not, right? So make sure that you spell check before you put it on slide, okay?
So next speaker is the last.
Okay, good afternoon, our attendants. Today, I'm going to share with you about the application of fibrous biofilter in recirculating aquaculture system. As you know, nowadays, commercial aquaculture system has grown rapidly for supporting the consumer demand of good quality protein food. Therefore, the aquaculturists try to produce the largest quantity of aquatic animals in a limited space. But unfortunately, they discharge the wastewater into the river. The mission of environmental engineer is how to design the wastewater treatment system for removing nitrogen from unconsumed feed and animal waste and return the clean water back to aquaculture tank again as recirculated system and without discharge any wastewater. Normally, there are two kinds of microorganisms that involve in nitrogen treatment process, like and dislike oxygen. Ammonia and nitrite can be removed with by the first group of microorganisms under high oxygen availability, while nitrate is treated by the second group in oxygen absent condition and to proceed always operate in the separation of bioreactors. It sounds difficult, right? Hence, my research aims to integrate both process within aquaculture tank in order to reduce the cost of reactor construction and also decrease the space for reactor installation. The concept is we find some material that act like a house for microorganisms and we call it biofilter. Imagine outside the house or on the surface of biofilter, microorganisms can contact with oxygen and play the role in ammonia and nitrite treatment. At the same time, deep inside of biofilter, the intricate fibers that act like a wall can prevent oxygen from reaching the core center as a result in oxygen absent condition. So another group of microorganisms can multiply and remove nitrate inside of biofilter. The results show that this idea is work. Ammonia nitrite and nitrate in treatment tank that installed with fibrous biofilter were kept within the acceptable level, whereas the elevated concentration of nitrogen compound that impact on animal health and bring the cause of disease were found in the control. So far, this fibrous biofilter can be adapted in a pilot scale for a largest farm and also in marine and branchial system. That is my next step project. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kun Pen Picha. All right. I think I understand what your work is. But I got lost in the technicality of the presentation, which I guess you could improve that. You could improve that. But the overall objective of the research and the results is clear. That's good.
Okay. I like your presentation. I think when you speak, we can clearly
hear what you speak, right? And you move around, you engage the audience, you have your hand gesture. I think that will keep the interest of the audience. This is closer to my expertise, so it's okay. So I understand. But I think, like, you said, like, the treatment with the biofilter is acceptable. Then I want to see which level is acceptable. You should have, could have a line that say, oh, below this is okay, above this is not okay, so that makes it your objective more clear. Okay.
I agree. I spent a lot of times looking at the graph, and I got confused from the beginning. But once you explained it, then I get it. But it took me a little bit of while to look at it. So I guess maybe changing the graph to a little bit more simple graph. Yeah. But I like your presentation. Yeah.
So we finish the first 9 competitors now. We will take a break for 10 minutes and we will come back for another interesting session. Thank you. Okay, hello. Okay. Welcome back to 3-Minute Thesis in the preliminary round. And before we start the last 9 competitors, I would like to remind you about the Long-D program, the internship program for the postgrad students. So in this occasion, I would like to invite Khun Tu from the tech company to give us a short information about this program. Please give a big round of applause for Khun Tu.
Good afternoon, everyone. So happy to see all of you guys here. So I'll give you a short explanation of Long-D program. Actually, it's the first year of DTAC to welcome postgrad interns. Basically, we would like to give you very exciting opportunities to explore DTAC. Well, instead of doing something with the copy machines or going to buy something for lunch for senior colleagues, you will be assigned to work on a very exciting project, which you will use it as your achievement in your resume. For example, if you guys are from the engineering department, you may be assigned to work in the communication department or maybe in the HR department. So basically, it is a very exciting program. So if you guys are interested, application starts on 1st of March. So you can follow us on facebook.com/longddtech. Okay. And I've seen so many of you took pictures of our DTAC house. So please feel free to do so. Take pictures, take photos, as many as you want. And then please, if possible, insert hashtag explore DTAC on your Facebook or Instagram so that I can get your feedback whether you like it or whether you have any comments for DTAC to improve. Okay, so thank you very much.
Okay, let's start with the last 9 competitors. The last 9 competitors, I would like to introduce the first one, Khun Priyaporn Pongunwat. The second, Khun Sapisa. Sasipha Wong Sura Paithun. And the third, Khun Surapon Warapatharathon. Khun Thammawit Suwanapan. Khun Thitapon Kanokratana. Khun Vashira Putichem. Khun Varut Tanjarin. Khun Virawat Ponrung Rungshok. Khun Vishaya Rong Sayamanon. And ladies and gentlemen, please give a big round of applause to our first speaker on this section. Khun Priyaporn Pongunwat from Environmental Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, for speaking in the title of autotrophic ammonia oxidation of ammonia oxidizing archaea and bacteria in wastewater treatment plants by DNA stable isotope probing technique.
High ammonia concentration is toxic to living in environment, especially living in water. In natural, ammonia can be removed by biological process. High ammonia concentration is toxic to living in environment, especially living in water. In natural, ammonia can be removed by biological process. The important step of biological process in ammonia removal is ammonia oxidation. That's what's driven by ammonia oxidizing archaea or AOA and ammonia oxidizing bacteria or AOB. What is AOA and AOB? It is the microbe that were found in several environments around the world. They are different in size and cell structure, but they have the same gene that can produce enzyme to digest ammonia to nitrite in ammonia oxidation reaction. We always believe that AOA and AOB perform autotrophic growth. What is autotrophic growth? It is the activity of microbes that can use carbon dioxide as the carbon salt. However, researchers recently found that some species of AOA and AOB did not perform autotrophic growth in some environments, such as in soil, in wastewater. So AOA and AOB activity in wastewater still be unclear. It brings to the question of this research that what is the actual activity of AOA and AOB in wastewater treatment plant during ammonia removal? Why we have to focus in wastewater? Because ammonia concentration helps to control before discharging wastewater into environment to protect the living. How can we prove that activity? First of all, we set the hypothesis that AOA and AOB in wastewater still be perform autotrophic growth during ammonia removal. And we will use isotope technique to prove their activity. AOA and AOB will be applied carbon dioxide that were labeled with 13 carbon. That after they consume carbon dioxide, 13 carbon labeled into their cell, the new cell will contain only 13 carbon that heavier than the old cell that contain only 12 carbon. And then we can separate the new cell that heavier than the old cell to identify and prove their activity. And this research can confirm that AOA and AOB in wastewater treatment plant still be confirmed autotrophic activity during the ammonia removal. And this result has the important knowledge to further study to find that who is the major role of ammonia oxidation in wastewater treatment plant between AOA and AOB, as it will help to improve the efficiency of ammonia removal in wastewater treatment plant design in the future. Thank you.
So let's see the comment.
Okay, interesting presentation. Yes, I like that you try to explain the technical jargon, like autotrophic. So when you explain it, oh, I know what it means, right? So then I can follow your presentation. And I think like you're a bit rushing towards the end because I know that your time is up. So the speeds keep getting faster and faster. So maybe you should manage your time or plan it ahead so that you don't have to rush at the end. Okay. And it's carbon 12 and carbon 13, not 12 carbons or 13 carbons, right? You should switch it around, okay?
I agree. I can follow the first 2 minutes, but the last minute I couldn't follow. It's just too fast for me. And I think you still have a little bit more time to do, so you should improve on that.
Yes, the speed of your speech is a bit fast, so that's that. And I think for me, I could not follow some of the technical terms that you mentioned, and maybe it would help to tone down the technicality a little bit and reduce the speed. Okay, thank you.
And the next speaker is Khun Sasipha Wong Surapaitun from Electrical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering. And she will speak in the title of Power Development Planning Considering Regional Condition and Power Plan Response to Load Change.
Imagine that you are the owner of Goreng Restaurant. There are 6 branches in different regions of Thailand like this. The number of your customers is increasing every day. And that is also the internship policy. The problem is that you have to manage how many workers you need to hire to make your customers satisfied without losing profit. So you must plan to balance demand and supply, right? Similar to electricity market, electricity demand rises up. The supplier have to provide enough energy, like adding the new power plants to prevent blackout. That's why we must prepare power development planning, or PDP. But the original PDP has 4 in managing demand and supply, which are, firstly, they analyze the system as a whole area so that they cannot determine which area should be improved first. Let's take an example. Your restaurant in the north branch needs more supply, but you expand the restaurant in the south instead. Why? Because you didn't know where demand is more than supply. Even the supply is increased, however, there must be an unnecessary transmission cost. That is, you have to send food from south to north. Secondly, they didn't concern about the fluctuation of renewable energy, such as solar and wind turbine. And then, okay, go back to your restaurant again. If we compare the renewable energy as the internships, so the internship cannot fully responsible for an increasing demand in rush hour, right? Therefore, you require more than normal chefs, like a master chef who has high potential to teach and cook at the same time. It's concluded that adding the renewable energy in the system, it will be more complicated to manage the system. As the problems explained, my new simulated PDP proposed the more effective way in identifying the problem area and the suitable power plant to respond the instability of renewable energies. The same principle can apply to every business model. So, the more cautious plan is, the higher successful chance is. Thank you.
I like the tone. I like the speed. But I'm not very sure about the restaurant story. For me, I get confused when you compare your thesis with running a restaurant. And towards the end, when you have 30 seconds left, you don't describe it clear enough, at least to me, how are you going to balance all this electricity. So I'm a little bit confused after you finish. How are you going to do it? Yeah.
Well, I think for me, the restaurant analogy works. Okay, it shows the needs to balance the demand and supply. Okay, but I like the tone in the sense that it's layman enough that any people can understand. Okay, but it lacks the rigorous results that should come out of the research. Okay, it's like you're only presenting the introduction of your research. You're not presenting the result of the research.
Okay, I like Jamanot. I like the restaurant analogy, but I think you use a little bit
too much of the analogy. Maybe you start off with the analogy and then okay, we start to get the idea and then you stop and then you dive into the content of your research. I think that would be better. So you keep going back to the restaurant and say, oh, maybe you want to open a restaurant, you not want to do like a master degree here, just want to cook or something. And I like your pace. You pace yourself very well. You speak very clearly. So I think a lot of audience can follow your presentation.
And our next speaker, everybody, please welcome Khun Surapon Warapatrapon from Computer Engineering Faculty of Engineering, who's speaking in the title of Real-Time Navigation and Obstacle Detection System for the Blind Using Stereo Camera.
Thank you. So, hi. What will be happen if one day you cannot use your eye anymore? How many people that you will fight and getting hit? That sounds horrible, right? But don't worry about that, because you still have your hearing sense. So my PhD research proposed the novel obstacle detection and navigation system for the people with disability, which allow the blind and people with disability to reach and access the world again. Okay? For getting started with my purpose, the stereo image is getting from the stereo camera and convert to the depth image. The depth image is an image that contains the distance information, the distance between the obstacle and the user. The next segment, the depth image to the depth accumulative information, we call DAI feature. Our contribution, the DAI feature used to separate the obstacle and the foreground in the high performance. The results show that when using our solution, the detection accuracy is 97.5% and 20 times faster when compared with traditional method. So the final step, we convert the obstacle region to the stereo waveform. That frequency and duration of waveform represent the shape and position of obstacle. By the output feedback, we use bone conduction feedback. The bone conduction feedback is a feedback that allows the user to still hearing the surrounding environment voice. And for our practice, the user can understand and recognize the shape of obstacle and position. And finally, we hope that our research can flip and improve the quality of Thailand people with disability life and allow them to get out of the home to going to the new place that they never visited with more safety, more confidence, and more independence. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Khun Surapon. I think that works. And the work with any type of work that help the disabilities, I think, is something that you can easily get support from the audience. Okay, and like this, you started by mentioning that, you know, imagine a world that you cannot see things. This is something that you can relate the audience into, like, you know, close your eyes. Tell the audience to close your eyes for 1 minute or something and listen to you. And that will actually help your presentation so that they can focus more and they can appreciate the work that you do. There are some technical terms that you mentioned, but I think it's minor, so I guess we can skip that.
Okay, I like your slide. I think it's very effective. I think, like, just looking at your slide, I kind of have an idea that what you will be talking about, and then you incorporate your slide into your presentation quite well. So I, I like it, but then you might need to work on your pronunciation a little bit more. An obstacle, because sometimes you pronounce it, when you pronounce it, the word obstacle comes up a lot, right? Then you should pronounce it correctly. Otherwise, people might think you talk about something else. That's also my pet peeve, sorry.
I like the slides, except the last pictures with the output bone conduction. If you actually put the picture of the headphone, it would just clear the whole thing. At first, you talked about blindness. You talk about people with disabilities problems. But at the end, you conclude that all the disabilities, disabled people, it kind of confused me at the end. Are you talking about only the blind, or are you talking about all kinds of disabled, you know?
Thank you, Khun Surapon, for the excellent presentation. And our next speaker is Khun Thammawit Suwarnapan from Mechanical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, in the title of Microfluidic Spiral Microchannel.
Hello. Speaking of one of the most dangerous diseases, so you would think about cancer, that's right? Unfortunately, cancer is not only one of the most lethal and dangerous diseases, but it is also the leading cause of death in the world, or even our home country. There are more than 60,000 patients die every year, and this is a huge number. In order to reduce the number of patients, we need to fully understand cancer cell behavior properly and correctly, and then we will be able to treat patients efficiently and effectively. In the olden day, according to the conventional method, we took a piece of sample and then analyzed it. However, the behavior of cell-to-cell interactions changed their biological property all the time, and we could not receive the correct data. And the question is, how can we get the correct data? The answer is so simple, pretty simple, just separate particle as a single cell. This is how my thesis gets started. So my PhD thesis is about helping doctors and researchers to analyze biological cancer cells using the advanced technological device known as microfluidics. This is a thing. The working principle of microfluidics are divided into three stages. First stage is to sort particle in different size, and second stage is to trap particle as a single cell. And the final stage is to release particle out of the system to further analyze biological cancer cells. According to the previous experiment, it was found that the efficiency of cell separations was about 40 and 80% for the particle of 10 and above 15 micrometers in the emitters. And for the efficiency of trapping, it was about 15%. Even though this number is not quite high, right, but it's provided with a high percentage of cell viability, about 95%. So we wholeheartedly believe that in the future, we will be able to have more understanding about cancer cell behavior that come from the change and abnormality of cells in human or animals. And we will be able to provide a better treatment and save people's life. Thank you.
First thing, you should put the microphone closer to your mouth. Okay, it keeps fading in, fading out. So I couldn't hear part of your presentation. And another comment, I don't see the connection between microfluidics with the cancer cells. Why do you want to sort the cells? Why do you want to trap the cells? What's the objective of this thing? And the slides doesn't relate to cancer cells at all. So I got confused.
Yeah, I got confused with the slides as well. I think it's better if you want to explain first, you do the sorting and then the trapping and then the releasing is. You can do it very simple. Just put the number so I can follow what is first, because it looks like it's two separate, three separate things, and it's not connecting. And I think your gesture is a little bit, you're using your right hand too much. You do like almost like rapping. You do that. So better just control your rapping hands. Yeah?
Okay, not much more to add. I think in the beginning the motivation was good about, you know, how cancer is important and so on, but then we got lost in the middle, you know, as to how your work can help. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for all of the comments. The next speaker, everybody please welcome Khun Thitaporn Kanok Ratana from Electrical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, in the title of Vision-Based Hand Gesture, Recognition System for Elderly People.
Nearly 13 million seniors are hospitalized each year, and they stay longer than younger patients, according to federal government. Some of them are weakened by multiple chronic diseases and medications, and they also have no ability to talk or walk. As there are many elders in hospital and nursing home, it causes the difficulty for the caregivers to take care of all of them comprehensively. In nursing home, one in three elderly die within a year, yet fewer than 15% receive hospice care. This problem also occurs in hospital, as hospital staff often fail to feed the elder properly, get them out of bed enough, or control their pain adequately. As a result, elders can't be able to contact to anyone when they need help or when they would like to tell their needs, such as food, water, medicine, or toilet. From this problem, it is really important for both elders and caregivers to use the monitoring system. So now you may wonder, what type of monitoring system is important for the elders? Imagine yourself, what is the easiest way to express your feelings without saying any words for human? The answer is body language. And the easiest way to do body language is hand gesture. So, based on that, I developed the system, a vision-based hand gesture recognition system. And my system has three main procedures. The first, elders have to show their hand to the camera without wearing gloves or any additional devices. Second, the system will classify the meanings of hand gesture. And the last, the message will be sent to the system to the mobile phone of the caregiver immediately. However, there are some elderly people who have symptoms like memory loss and shaky hand in which they can't control their hand to be stable and remember the complex gestures. So I developed my system to be the vision-based dynamic hand gesture recognition system and also define the simple six hand gestures, which are very easy for the elders to remember, including help, water, food, toilet, facility, and accident. Finally, I would like to say that this research truly benefits for the elders' lives. So if you love them, you should care them. Thank you.
Impressive. That was good. Very good. I think we got the picture and the motivation is there, and I think the technicality is not that strong, but it's okay because we are talking about, you know, making the presentation to the general public. So I think that was good overall. Thank you.
Okay, I love your presentation. Okay, good use of the slide. It's very effective. Your movement, your hands gesture is very effective. You engage the audience. Two thumbs up.
I agree. Very good presentation. You have rehearsed quite a few times. I can tell. And you are very spot on. Do you have more things if you have more time to say? Do you
have more time?
Yeah, I mean, if you have 5 more minutes, do you have more things to say?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think cut down a little bit of the introduction and you will be perfect. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Khun Thitaporn, for the excellent presentation. And our next speaker is Khun Wachira Puthichem from Technopreneurship and Innovation Management Interdisciplinary Programs Graduate School in the title of Innovative Small-Scale Wind Turbine for Electricity Gathering Device.
Good afternoon, everyone. As we know that the electricity demand increased every year in industrial section, residential, commercial, and also transportation. Everybody tried to develop the technology to make more electricity to supply our people. With the conventional technology for electricity, we still have the question for the conventional technology as for nuclear power and hydropower and also the solar energy, because of the we have the experience with the Chernobyl power plant and Fukushima in Japan for the nuclear plant, right? We don't want to face that in our country. And also for the water hydropower, it rely on the global warming, right? In the future, we don't know how we survive with this technology, and also the solar energy may be the big issue in the future for electric waste. But the one thing for the wind energy is really clean technology. But when we consider that with our resort for natural winds in our country or our region, right, it's difficult to implement and difficult to distribute because the cost is not effective. So when we consider that, what is the resort we have in our country or our region? The non-natural energy, winds in our region is a lot. But at this time, we did not utilize well to make the electricity for this region. In the past, 185 years ago, Michael Faraday developed the technology, invent the generator with the basic sign that for the magnetic move through the copper coil, we can generate electricity. But at this time, it's not enough. We rely on this technology for why? We have to demonstrate the innovative techniques to generate the electricity from the wind energy. We know that the large scale wind energy cannot implement due to the land, it requires the land a lot because it impacts the landscape and also the cost for its construction is very expensive. So in my thesis research, we will change the world with the innovative small scale wind turbine for electricity gathering device, especially for the low wind speed country. This technique will be combined the multi knowledge from engineering and also the material side to design the blade and the generator. We expect that we will recover the electricity 20% for our people. Thank you.
Wow, 1 second left. I almost think you won't finish in time. too much introduction. You start talking about your thesis in the last 30 seconds, and you spend 2.5 minutes talking about many, many things not related to your thesis, maybe related, but maybe not that important. And then the slides confuses me. I don't know what does wind energy has to do with train or with cargo ships, why you put it there. So, and I don't even know, like, what does your wind turbine does, right? Is it like just like the turbine that generates electricity from the wind is like this thing? But we already have this thing, right? Why would this change the world? That's a big claim, right? What's so special about your wind turbine? You should tell us that to make it more interesting.
I agree. I think your last 30 seconds is more interesting than your first 2.5 minutes. You don't need all these slide because everyone knows about wind turbine, wind energies, and especially the history is not really related, I think. And the last point is more important, so you should spend more time explaining what is your solutions and what is your approach to that solution.
Yeah, I think we all concur. We have the same impression, I think. It was a way too long introduction, way too long, and the focus of the thesis was not there. You know, I guess my understanding is that the focus is on the small scale wind turbine, but you just spend like, I don't know, 10 seconds on that, and we still don't understand what this work is about. It's like you spend 3 minutes on in the introduction of your work, but the work is not there. Okay, thank you.
And our next speaker, everybody please welcome Khun Warut Tan Chalern from Mining and Petroleum Faculty of Engineering in the title of Evaluations of Polymer Alternating Water Flooding in Multilayer Heterogeneous Water Flood Reservoir.
One big question in the oil field is that what are we going to do if the reservoir is depleted and the oil cannot be produced by itself anymore? One thing that can help solving this problem is the polymer, because when polymer is mixed with water, the water will become more viscous and it will slowly push the oil towards the producer so we can produce more oil. But you see this picture? If we inject the whole polymer slug into the reservoir, so the injectivity or the ease of injecting the polymer into the reservoir is very low because polymer itself is very viscous and is hard to inject. So we split the polymer slug into the solar one and divide it with water to increase the injectivity of the polymer. So in this thesis, we determine and we evaluate the recovery by using the oil recovery in the percentage. Oil recovery is the oil that we can produce over the total of oil in the reservoir. So let's see. First, the pre-flush. The pre-flush is the water that used to inject in the injector and then we detect at the producer. So the definition is that it used to determine if two wells are really connected or not and to increase the injectivity of the polymer. And it shows that when we use the pre-flush until we detect first at the producer, it will show the best result. The second one is the water slug between the polymer. So this one used to increase the injectivity of the polymer also. And in this study, it shows that if you use water slug just as low as 5% of the polymer slug, it will show the best result. That is because we just need small amount of water in order to increase the injectivity. More than that, it's just a waste of time. And the next one, the number of alternate cycle. We have run several cases from 1 to 5 cycles, and we found that use just 2 cycles will be enough because using more than that, polymer will be too small and not effective to improve the oil recovery. Finally, in conclusion, comparing to the typical polymer flooding, we get 8,000 barrels of oil more, which is approximately 14 million baht. So this technique will be an innovation and a practical way to increase the oil recovery in the future. Thank you.
I think you are very, very smart. I lost a little bit in the middle, but it's very interesting to that you put the conclusion at the end. It gives me hope of what you're doing is actually going to the right directions. But I can't comment on the content because I don't understand the whole thing. That actually indicates that you might be able to do a little bit better in terms of explaining people who don't know anything about this thing. Yeah.
Uh,
I like the tone of your presentation. It shows that you are enthusiastic, right? So it engaged the audience. But then the content is the opposite of the previous speaker. This is very technical. Okay, I'm a chemical engineer and I don't understand half of what you're saying, right? And I think you rely too heavily on your slides. I think simplify the slides, simplify the talk, and try to hit on the important point of your research.
Yeah, I would agree with that. The use of the presentation slide is not very effective. It's all over the place, and we could not focus on any one particular pieces. I think the use of the presentation here should be made to support what you are saying. It is not a presentation where you use in your defense. Okay, so you don't need to show all the details of the presentation, so on and so forth. I think the bottom line is over there, the 40 million baht per whatever you didn't mention, per week, per month, per year, but that is the bottom line. So you need to, like you said, simplify your methodology and your, I guess, your presentation as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Khun Varut, for the presentation and all of the comments. The next speaker is Khun Virawat Phonrung Rueang Chok from Nuclear Engineering, Faculty of Engineering, in the title of Development of a Portable Isotope Identifier Device.
First of all, I would like to introduce all of you in a simple word. Actually, electromagnetic radiation is just a form of energy. Let's see the figure. It is electromagnetic spectrum. Yes, now you know. The visible light is a type of energy. And we could see that. The electromagnetic wave, it exists everywhere and they are really useful. As waveform, moving toward to the right-hand side, this electromagnetic spectrum become more and more dangerous, yet it's still useful. Our phone are using wireless communication in microwave region. Your TV remote control is used infrared to change the channel. Gamma ray also. We use gamma ray in the many industry, many application. Let's talk about my thesis. My work is to develop a radioisotope identifier. Because we cannot see, we cannot catch, we cannot touch, any human sense cannot detect the radiation, so we do need to something to detect them. My device not only to detect the gamma radiation, but also have ability to know or identify what the source is. Okay. It helps us a lot when handling the emergency situation. For example, when we found cesium-134 in the air, so we can know somewhere has a fission reaction because cesium-134 is released from fission reaction. Why I need to do this device? One of the reasons is there are still no company in Thailand which able to produce it. Although we do able import it from at one country, but the cost maintenance and the price is really costly. Okay, ขอบคุณครับ
All right. Well, that happened to me sometimes when I'm on stage, in the middle of sentence and we just go blank. What? So that's okay. I think the work that you do, one thing that I like is when you mentioned about the fact that none of our human senses can detect the radioactive or radioactivity, I don't know how you say that. So that's why you need this device to help detect this type of activity. But what's unclear to me is what type of detection or what type of fire are you talking about? Are you talking about just saying that, oh, this is this area is not safe, or are you talking about that this area is not safe because of this particular spectrum? Okay, so that is something that you can be more specific about. And I guess maybe you don't need to go into the details of how you do that, because that would be too technical, all right? But you could make your presentation much more interesting. You know, this sort of thing you can relate to, like, accidents in Fukushima or whatever. Okay, then people will understand the importance.
Okay, yes, a lot of silence. Dead air, right? That means probably need to rehearse it a little bit more, right? One question is, like, you should tell us what benefit would your device give us? Where would we encounter the gamma radiation, and why do we need to use your device? I don't think we're gonna go walk around and just, oh, let's measure the gamma radiation around here, right? But you should say, like, in which situation that your device would be useful, right? And tell us, like, how useful could it be, how can it be used, and then that will give more impact to your presentation.
Did you forget your script, or you ran out of things to say? You forgot. Okay. That's happened, so it's normal. What I would like to see more, instead of put your, you said my device, what is your device? You know, it's like, how are you going to come up with your device? So it's kind of blank for me. It just, anyone can just put my device, and it just, you know, so you need more information on how do you come up with your device, and what kind of technologies, how you make it portable when others cannot, or how can you make it cheaper? You know, not into a good, like, length of detail, but at least give me some details on how do you do it.
Yeah. Thank you, Khun Virat, for the presentation. And this is our last speaker for today. Everyone, please welcome Khun Vichaya Rongsayamanon from Hazardous Substance and Environmental Management Interdisciplinary Programs Graduate School in the title of Bio-based Solution for Clean Up Oil Spill.
I'm sure that everybody here like to swim in the clear seawater and play a white sand on the beach. What if tomorrow you have a plan to go to the sea with your family, and they have the oil spill in that area? The sand and the seawater were totally black. What would you feel? Nowadays, there are many cases of the oil spill in the world. The 10 biggest cases found that it released 5,000 millions of the crude oil into the ocean. It's not effect to the traveler, but it's also effect to the people around that area and the animal. The common method that has been used to remove the residual oil from the seawater is the using of dispersant. What is dispersant? The dispersant is the mixture of the chemical surfactant and the organic solvent. It could disperse the oil into the small droplets, making it easy to move by wind or wave, and some could degrade it by sunlight or bacteria. Unfortunately, we found that the chemical surfactant caused the serious toxic effect to the marine organism and accumulated into the fish, birds, seaweed, or marine plant for a long, long time. To overcome this problem, my work introduced a new substance we call biosurfactant,
as a novel dispersion. The biosurfactant is produced from bacteria and has a structure like a chemical surfactant, but it has more advantages over the chemical surfactant, which are low toxicity and could use at the various extreme conditions. In my work, also improved the dispersion efficiency of the dispersant by using the Ning concept of the surfactant mixture without adding the organic solvent. Finally, my work got three advantages from the bio-based dispersant. The first one is it environmental friendly to the marine organism. Second, it could be used with the specific oil type. And the last one is could promote the petroleum degrading bacteria. Let's use the bio solution to save the environment, and you can go to the sea whenever you want. Thank you.
Thank you. I think maybe for me, you spend too much time in the beginning, in the introduction, because oil spill is a rather common problem that everybody has seen at least on TV, so you don't need to spend too much time on that. And then you introduce the dispersant using the chemical base, and then you introduce your new products, which is bio-based. I would like you to spend more time on that, you know, and you mentioned three advantages of using the bio-based agent, and we would like to see, you know, more details on that, and that I would imagine that there would be some drawbacks to using your bio-based agent as well, so we'd like to hear that too.
Okay, I like your slide, it's very cute. But I have some problem with the title. It's for cleanup oil spill. It could be for oil spill cleanup or for cleanup for oil spill. Yes, grammar freak. Okay, but I like the tone and the pace of your presentation. I think you speak very clearly, so we can follow it. And I like that you give us finish with the tagline, so we can remember your presentation.
I like your presentation. The slides, apart from oil spill, everyone knows about the bad things about oil spill, so you don't need to really talk about that. What I would have done is that I would compare the chemical surfactant and your bio surfactant, how better your product is, more than just, you know, put these things. Yeah.
So we go to the end of the speaking section. So everyone, please give a big round of applause to all our speakers. And I would like to thanks to our commentators and also our judges for hard work today. And may I invite Ajahn Dr. Shutimon Sathirapipatkun to present all judges and commentators with a token of pleasant. So, kai kon dia ha. Ajahn O so rian chern Ajahn Manoj kon lai ha. ค่ะ เรียนเชิญอาจารย์มาโนทค่ะ
ของอยู่ไหนของด้านหลัง
ซื้อนะคะขอโทษนะคะแป๊บหนึ่งหายไปไหนอะ
อย
ู
่ซะเงียบเลย
ขอบพระคุณมากค่ะขอเสียงปรบมือด้วยค่ะเรียนเชิญอาจารย์
ท่านต่อไปนะคะเรียนเชิญอาจารย์ดร. อัควัชสิริสุขค่ะขอบคุณท่านอาจารย์มากๆนะคะท่านต่อไปนะคะจากบริษัทสกูต้านะคะคุณสุวัฒน์ปฐมภควันหรือคุณบอยค่ะเรียนเชิญค่ะ
ก็ต่อไปเป็นคณะกรรมการนะคะเรียนเชิญอาจารย์ณัฐมาค่ะค่ะท่านต่อไปเรียนเชิญอาจารย์พิสุทธิ์ค่ะก็คนต่อไปนะคะน้องวิรินค่ะเชิญค่ะแล้วก็ท่านต่อไปนะคะเรียนเชิญน้องภูดิษฐ์ค่ะแล้วก็เดี๋ยวเรียนเชิญทุกท่านถ่ายรูปร่วมกันที่เวทีนะคะ
เดี๋ยวเรียนเชิญขอคอมเมนเตอร์กรรมการแล้วก็ผู้เข้าแข่งขันก่อนนะคะรูปหนึ่งรูปนะคะทีต้องเป็นทีละเซตเพราะว่าคนเยอะนิดนึงเรียนเชิญเลยค่ะเรียนเชิญด้านหน้าเลยนะคะหันหน้าไปด้านนี้เลยค่ะเดี๋ยวเอาด้านนี้เป็นฉากค่ะเชิญยืนเลยค่ะช่วยจับแถว
อาจารย์
คอมเมนเตอร์แล้วกรรมการรวมกันเลยค่ะ
ผู้เข้าแข่งขันวันนี้ค่ะ
เอาเซนนี่ก่อนได้ค่ะเซนนี่ก่อนให้กรรมการกับคอมเมนเตอร์ก่อนนะคะหนึ่งรูปค่ะกล้องเก็บหมดไหมคะ
กล้องไหนก่อนแจ้งด้วยนะครับกล้องไหนก่อน
เลข3นะ3 minute ค่ะโลโก้โลโก้ลูกเสือ ต่อไปนะคะผู้เข้าแข่งขันทั้ง18ท่านวันนี้เชิญเรียนเชิญเลยค่ะเข้าถ่ายรูปพร้อมกับอาจารย์เลยค่ะ
ด้านไหนดีนั่งก็ได้นะคะด้านหน้าด้านหน้าเก็บถึงไหมนั่งด้านหน้าได้ค่ะ
ใครสะดวกย่อย่อให้หน่อยได้ค่ะรบกวนย่อ
ได้ไหมคะถ้ากระโปรงไม่สะดวก
พี่เอกด้านนี้ด้านนี้เก็บได้ไหมคะ
อันนี้ท่
านเก็บได้อยู่ไหมคะตรงนี้น่าถึงตรงนี
้แล้วถ้าทุกคนจะอยู่ได
้นั่นน่ะสิ
ให้นั่งจะได้นั่งบอกสักที
จะได้เก็บไปนี่เลยเก็บเอาต้องชู3นิ้วมั้ยคะต้องชู3นิ้วมั้ยคะ
3นิ้วด้วยนะทุกเสือ
3อัน
สักครู่นะคะเล่นฟิกเลย
โอเคค่ะทำหน้าโอเคทำหน้าโอเค
ดีเทลเยอะมากเลยถ่ายรูปเนี่ย
ทำเท่าโอเควางไว้ที่ตาด้านขวา
โอเคค่ะเดี๋ยวขอรูปรวมทั้งหมดทุกคนนะคะแต่ว่าคราวนี้รบกวนหันหน้าไปทางด้านนู้นค่ะเพราะว่าทางนี้จะไม่พอ
ขั้นบันไดเลย
ตามขั้นบันไดเลยค่ะทุกคนรวมกันตรงกลางนะคะรวมเรียนเชิญทุกท่านเลยนะคะจะได้เห็นห้องบรรยากาศห้อง
คณะกรรมการ
เราด้วย
แถวหน้าได้เลยนะคะ
ขอเชิญเลยค่ะเชิญเลยค่ะขอรวมกันตรงกลางนิดนึงนะคะ
ตรงกลางเลยค่ะ
ทุกท่านเลยยืนบนขั้นก็ได้ค่ะ
ได้เหรอ
อ๋อหรือว่าให้อาจารย์พูดหน่อยไหม
ให้อาจารย์พูดหรือเชิญ
ครับผมเดี๋ยวเรียนเชิญอาจารย์แถวหน้านะครับอาจารย์ยืนแถวหน้าและทุกท่านยืนขึ้นไป
ครับมันก็ธรรมดาตอนสอบดีเฟนซ์นี่พูด30นาทียังไม่จบสักทีได้พูด3นาทีก็เป็นอะไรที่สดชื่นดีแปลกใหม่ดีก็ดีครับสนุกดีแล้วก็หวังว่าคงจะเกิดขึ้นเรื่อยๆนะครับก็ถ้าอยากให้ช่วยก็ถ้าว่างก็จะมาช่วยนะครับขอบคุณมากครับ
ขอบคุณอาจารย์อัครวัฒน์มากนะคะเดี๋ยวท่านต่อไปหล
ัง
จากที่อาจารย์ณัฐมาถูกไหมคะอาจารย์ณัฐมาจากคณะอักษรได้พูดตอนเปิดไปแล้วคราวนี้อยากมาฟังความรู้สึกหลังจากฟังภาษาอังกฤษของเด็กทั้งห้องนี้มาบ้าง เราต้องมี before และ after นะคะเชิญค่ะ
คราวนี้เห็นว่าให้เน้นเกี่ยวกับภาษาอังกฤษเท่านั้น ใช่ไหมคะ ค่ะค่ะแต่ว่าก็คอมเมนต์ตามเนื้อผ้าเลยนะคะก็ได้เห็นความพยายามค่ะของทุกคนมาอย่างดีแต่ก็คิดว่าพยายาม เรียบเรียงภาษาอะไรมาแต่คิดว่าเราอาจจะยังมีปัญหาบ้างทางด้านการออกเสียงบางคำหรือว่า grammar อย่างที่เรียนตอนต้นแต่โดยรวมสามารถสื่อความได้มากกว่าสิ่งที่อาจจะผิดพลาดบ้างทางภาษาเพราะอย่างที่เรียนอ่อนต้นว่าถ้าสามารถ communication ได้แต่ถึงจะมีข้อผิดบ้างอันนั้นเป็นสิ่งที่ไปปรับปรุงได้ค่ะแต่โดยภาพรวมครูก็ฟังแล้วหมายถึงเข้าใจภาษาแต่ถึงแม้เนื้อหาจะตามไม่ค่อยได้หลายๆเรื่องนะคะก็ขอเน้นตรงจุดนี้เป็นจุดหลักด้วยค่ะว่าในด้านภาษาควรจะให้เนื้อความเนี่ยคนที่อยู่นอกวงการฟังแล้วเข้าใจแต่บางเรื่องนี่เข้าใจชัดเจนเลยนะคะค่ะขอบคุณค่ะ
ขอบพระคุณอาจารย์ครับขอบคุณครับ
ค่ะก็สำหรับวันนี้นะคะก็เราจะจบเซสชั่นการพรีเซนเทชันในนี้ไปแล้วนะคะต่อไปก็จะเรียนเชิญทุกท่านนะคะร่วมรับประทานอาหารในดินเนอร์พาร์ตี้ของเราจะอยู่ที่ชั้น33ด้านบนนะคะรบกวนทุกท่านใช้บันไดตรงโถงกลางนะคะเดี๋ยวมีพัตเตอร์นะคะเป็นคนเดินนำถ้าอาจารย์ท่านไหนว่างสะดวกอยู่ด้วยก็เรียนเชิญด้วยนะคะรับประทานอาหารร่วมกันค่ะ
บอกกรรมการขอจากนี้มีอะไรบ้างไปก่อน
อ๋อลืมบอกเรื่องสำคัญก็คือผลที่จะประกาศในดินเนอร์ปาร์ตี้ค่ะประกาศระหว่างกินไปมีความสุขไปได้เข้ารอบเราจะประกาศกันแบบมิสยูนิเวิร์สวันนี
้ครับผม
จับมือแล้วออกทีละคนจับมือคู่แล้วออกทีละคนอย่างนี
้แบบว่ากินไประทึกไปเลยทีเดียวนะครับผมก็เรียนเชิญทุกท่านนะครับเดี๋ยวเดินตามผมมาเลยนะครับเดี๋ยวเดินไปที
่เรียนเชิญเลยค่ะขอบคุณมากค่ะ
ที่สามครับผม
ครับก่อน